All right, let's get started then. Okay, my name's Alan Ho. I lead our developer relations at Apigee.
I'm Sabha Parameswaran. I'm with the platform engineering from Pivotal. I work with partners and customers.
And we're going to talk a little bit about graph databases. We're going to talk a little bit about microservices. So to give a little background on Apache Usergrid, which is a backend as a service, I want to talk a little bit about microservices. We all know that kind of the goal of a microservice is to break big monoliths into small services. But going a little bit deeper, there's two types of microservices that are that you can break them up into. One is business logic services, and the other is data services. Now, business logic services, we hear a lot about business logic services and creating new apps, and these are supposedly stateless services. But what about services that need persistence, right? How can we do that a little better? Well, regardless of whether it's a business logic service or a data service, two things need to happen for microservices. They need to be isolated from each other, and they need to have an API. You don't want to have any database connections. You don't want to have any like direct socket connections. They all should have a API. So kind of the like the panacea for deployment and management of business logic services is, okay, let's get a lightweight scripting language or Java, something of that sort, put in containers, and we scale up the number of containers. That's kind of like the way that a lot of people are thinking. And then for data services, kind of the question is, can you extend that same approach, especially data services that need web scale? Well, so a lot of people always see is that they try to put Cassandra in a container, they put a lightweight, and then they put a lightweight scripting language in a container, and then put the lightweight scripting language to call the NoSQL database. There's a problem. Containers solve nothing, right? Because at the end of the day, NoSQL sucks. And it sucks only when you're doing it at web scale. I'm talking about at 1,000 TPS, even though it was designed for that. And what are the common issues? So, you know, developers are not very good at doing indexing. And when you get up to, the 1,000, 10,000 TPS level, having the developer learn how to index their database is very hard. The second is, for a lot of NoSQL databases, taking advantage, especially of the, taking actual advantage of the NoSQL database, optimizing it for parallel calls is also difficult. And last but not least, when things go wrong, when you have latency especially, it is extremely hard to debug a NoSQL database, right? And web service, like microservices, makes it worse, because what you're end up doing is managing hundreds, if not thousands, of instances of both databases of these NoSQL databases, and for all the things I just talked about, it just gets worse. You're not really solving the problem when it comes to data services. So, what's in a different approach, right? The different approach that Apache Usergrid uses is that it's a radically new way to create a multi-tenant data service on top of a single Cassandra cluster. It has an out-of-the-box API for it, right? So you don't have to stand up another, a lightweight scripting language in another container. It has a bunch of kind of out-of-box capabilities, especially for mobile, like push notifications, and has SDKs for Android, iOS, and JavaScript. So what is a mobile backend as a service? Well, simply, these are not just a data store, but also out-of-the-box backend services that are needed to build common apps. So this is like geolocation, users, push notifications, et cetera. And the key, what's different about Usergrid is that it's open source. So who here heard about parse? Anybody heard of parse? Yeah, Facebook shut that down earlier this year. Anybody heard about StackMob? StackMob? Yeah. When PayPal bought that, they shut that down too. Anybody hear about Firebase? Google I/O is talking a lot about Firebase. I don't know if Google's going to shut that down, but if your software is not open source, you just can't afford to have a vendor lock you in. So the nice thing about Usergrid is that it's open source. So no matter what you no matter what your vendor is doing, you know that at least your data is not going to go away. So what are some use cases? Well, for the case of Pivotal, this is really backend as a service is really a part of a bigger story of a mobile reference architecture. So you have the backend as a service that's great for storing like location data, user preferences, et cetera. You have an API gateway for managing legacy applications as well as new services. And then you also have streaming event engines for capturing things like analytics of that sort. This is one use case that we have. This is our customer. This is a customer that's using this called Burberry. And they're using it for customer favorites. So this scenario, they have millions of customers. And then favorites is one of those things where you need scalable writes, because lots of people might be adding things to favorites. But you also need scalable reads. And what I mean by that is, if you have a favorite list from a famous celebrity that gets shared out by everybody, a lot of people are reading that one particular list. They also needed the idea of graph queries as well, and I'll get into it a little bit more, because every user has a list of favorites and wish lists, but being able to subquery items on that is very important. But most importantly is that it's the provisioning time. They didn't need to actually spend a whole lot of time standing up another Cassandra database, standing up a API front end to the database. It just happened automatically. So I'll kind of give you a quick demo to kind of show you what it's like before getting into some of the technology use cases. So this is the UI to it. Now, all these API calls I'm going to be making via the UI can be done also by a command line. And so to create a new application, it's simply you would press a button and you would create a new application. And this application is going to be isolated from all other applications. Let's take a look at some of this data here. So I typed get users and it gave me a list of users. I can also do searches over here too. So it's not a simple key value pair store, but there's actually indexing going underneath the hood too. Okay, so in this entity over here, you can put any kind of data you want. You can put in JSON blobs as well. And then you can also do other things too. So you can actually, it supports the concept of graphs. So I'll drill down into this particular user and I can look at the activities related to that user too. Oh, sorry, I got this wrong here.
You copied the get.
Oh, thank you.
Slash.
Okay. So this is what I'm showing you here is this user Jenny. I got the list of all the activities that she has done, and these activities may include things like likes. It could be including things like adding to cart, things of that sort. So there's a graph database underneath the hood. And you can even do subqueries on that graph. So for example, I want to find all the items that Jenny had liked that's under $2,000. Let's do that and see what happens. Whoops.
Is that user different?
Okay, this is a copy and paste issue. Oh, two LTs. Okay, so you can see here I just queried on this item, and then I can see that Jenny may be a liked a camera that is under $2,000. Okay, there was a little error here. Okay, so let's kind of go back to show the underlying technology about it. So inside, it's a combination of Tomcat talking to Cassandra and ElasticSearch. So we use Cassandra for storing the actual data as a source of records. And the reason why is because Cassandra gives you the ability to do multi-data center replications and is very, very scalable with sharding. And then we use ElasticSearch for doing all the indexing. Because you could throw any kind of thing inside, and we wanted to index all the fields, having ElasticSearch, which really just focuses on indexing, allowed us to get the best of the best from Cassandra and get the best of the best out of ElasticSearch. So from a graph data structure perspective, you can see here we can show, you know, there could be an app has multiple users, and user can own multiple lists, and each list can contain one or more products. So this is a very, very rich data model. It's not your basic key value pair data model. Again, it's built for web scale, and I gotta be able to put a little caveat here, right? Obviously, if you use hand-tuned Cassandra and you hand-tune ElasticSearch, you're gonna get much better performance. But for majority of the web scale use cases, which is in between the thousands and tens of thousands of scenario requests per second, you really don't need to do any of that tuning. Besides, your developers are not going to know how to tune that anyway, right? Okay, next part is sharding. So we've spent a lot of time sharding the data, and we've sharded every connection at each level so that whenever we're doing any queries, it's uniformly making queries across all the Cassandra Cassandra instances. So you're not getting this hot spot of data for a particular shard. And the other part that makes this very scalable is the indexing. So what happens is that when we do a write to the system, it hits the Tomcats, we immediately write it into Cassandra, and we also write it into a queue. The queue, then we have the Tomcats asynchronously pull the queue and read Cassandra and push it into ElasticSearch. And so what this means is that from an eventual consistency perspective, yes, when you can write very quickly and almost immediately get a response. Now, it won't show up in any of your queries immediately. It takes a little bit of time because we're doing this asynchronous indexing. But for many use cases, especially web scale use cases, this is totally fine from a user experience perspective. So I'm going to hand off to Sabu and talk a little bit more about how you can actually get this running on Cloud Foundry.
Well, welcome, everyone. So what we... Okay, to tell you the truth, I don't really know anything about MBAS or Usergrid or any of that. Their team came over to the industry day wherein we had different partners come in and try to help build service broker or applications or tiles for PCF. And we were able to accomplish the tile construction for Usergrid all in 2 days' time. Essentially, what we did was we created a BaaS release that encompasses the Cassandra, the ElasticSearch, and then we had Bosch errands that pushes a user grid application as an application to the Cloud Foundry, and we created a trial around it. And in the interest of time, we actually went with the Docker images of Cassandra and ElasticSearch rather than full-blown Bosch. So in terms of the standalone deployment, what you might be having is a Tomcat server running the user grid application and a separate installs of Cassandra and ElasticSearch, which you'll have to manage, you'll have to scale up, things like those. And if something goes down, you're on your own. You need to make sure the thing is up, someone has to monitor it, someone has to scale it up, someone has to provision the VMs, do all the stuff that you might have heard all through these days. And it's not cloud native. You will have to do all the heavy lifting. So with the PCF deployment, essentially the Cloud Foundry portion of PCF takes care of the app, the user grid app, and Bosch takes care of the ElasticSearch and Cassandra. And now, like, you have a cloud-native application running, you can scale up whenever you want to. You don't have to worry about the underlying cloud and the VMs, the health, everything is taken care of for you along with scaling and load balancing. Any questions so far? So this is a tile that we created. What are the benefits of running on PCF? You basically get the four levels of HA. I'm pretty sure everyone knows about the four levels of HA. You get the VM resurrection from Bosch. You get the multi-cloud capabilities. You don't have to worry about the scaling or load balancing or HA. And of course, there is persistence for these ones. And since we went with Docker, we could do it very rapid prototyping to get the thing out. In the future, we plan to do a full-blown Bosch release for both for Cassandra and ElasticSearch, so you can provide the parameters, whatever you need. You can customize it and build it to your own satisfaction. And there might be also a service broker integration. We already have a Cassandra service broker, so we would be able to let the user grid consume the Cassandra services through a service broker rather than doing a hard-coded endpoint integration. So here is a tile. It basically has very few configurations exposed to the user. So there is a user grid cluster name, the administration credentials, the SMTP server. For now, we had dummied it up. But this whole tile creation was like less than a day. Getting all the parts working together was 2 days, 2 to 3 days. And we can go into the apps manager and we can scale it if anyone wants to see that. So we can say start. Earlier it was with one instance, it's kind of starting up. Does anyone want to see ops manager scale up the VM instances?
Yeah, let's do it.
Yeah, that would take a little bit of time. So let's do that. The ops manager kind of does certain other housekeeping tasks, so it might take a little bit of time. Let's apply the changes. We will come back and test it. Okay. Ignorers. Yeah, that's one of the things. If you skip it, it just stays there. Okay. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. We'll kind of check it at the end of the call. So this is the plan for it. Like, depending on the user preference, probably we would invest our time and efforts to build a full Bosch release for these two. And what are the benefits? So I think I don't really have to reiterate it. Like, all the benefits that PCF brings to the table, we can, because Usergrid is a straightforward application and we were able to use the Docker Bosch release, we were able to create all these underlying Bosch releases, create the tile with it, and all the benefits that PCF brings to the table. So we could get the user grid out there as a tile right away. Probably we might be working more with Apigee for other products, so Edge Gateway or others in the future. Okay, so.
Yeah, so if there's a one takeaway that one you have is that if you're building microservices and you really need to build a micro data service, you don't want to be managing thousands, hundreds, or thousands of NoSQL databases, check out Usergrid, because it allows you to have one large NoSQL cluster, but let your app developers be able to provision data services themselves without having to go through all the pain of provisioning NoSQL or managing NoSQL databases themselves. And you can just go to GitHub. You can just download it from GitHub, clone it from GitHub, and try out the tile on Pivotal, Cloud Foundry, Marketplace.
Thank you.
We got some time for some questions.
Not really, because almost they are on the same network, it don't really be much of a difference. Performance might be different, but not the network. I don't really think so.
But you do raise a point, right? Like whenever you're running Cassandra when you're running any database in a VM, there is concerns, right? And so one of the nice things about running, running your database on bare metal is that you can still run it on bare metal if you want. You don't have to run it in a VM. And then you can actually still have that multi-tenancy on top of one large Cassandra cluster.
Yeah, for now, we were able to do a fast prototype using the Docker images of Cassandra, but our plan is to actually build proper Bosch release using full Cassandra, not the Docker image.
That allows you to actually deploy it onto bare metal very easily.
So you can see we are kind of creating the VMs for the Elasticsearch through Bosch. It's like you go into Ops Manager, you say, I want to scale up, and you're done.
Any other questions?
The server that you URL that you showed, it contains everything, right? All the tiles for PCF as well as Bosch and
so the tile, it's a custom tile we created for Usergrid. The Usergrid, it basically pushes an application of the Usergrid into CF through Bosch errand, and it also creates two separate set of jobs, one for Elasticsearch, one for Cassandra.
Okay.
Does that answer?
Yeah, thank you.
Compared to other MBASs, or? Usergrid is the only one that's an Apache MBAS, is Apache project. So it's the only Apache licensed one. I don't know of any MBASs that are open source and have a lot of adoption, especially from enterprise customers. That's maybe one difference. I do know that there were some MBASs that were based on top of relational databases, but honestly, they didn't go very far because why use an MBAS when it's so easy to deploy, when most developers know how to use a relational database, right? That's why I know of so far.
You had a question.
You said you had to use a Docker image for Cassandra because it's not available.
No. We can create a full-blown Cassandra Bosch release, but it does require some time. Because we were able to get a Docker image of Cassandra right away, we just downloaded it, we wrapped it with the Bosch release in like a half an hour.
Okay, but you can use Cassandra using Bosch if you want.
We also have a partner offering data stacks. There is a data stack style if you want to use the proper commercial one. You can consume the services of data stacks from the marketplace. That's another option. Or if you want to bring in this one, the whatever custom built one, yes, that's an option.
The reason why we chose Cassandra was because of its multi-data center replication, and just the fact that it's, of all the NoSQL databases out there, it was the most hardened for enterprise use cases. It's on GitHub, and you can fork it and then put in things like MongoDB. I know some people in the community were trying to think about using DynamoDB instead of Cassandra and still leveraging Elasticsearch for the indexing. But we haven't, Cassandra is pretty darn good for enterprise. The question is Elasticsearch part of Usergrid? It is a core part of Usergrid 2.0. You download Usergrid, and Elasticsearch and Cassandra are dependencies for Usergrid.
So it's an external dependency, but it is required for Usergrid to function. So we have got the three VMs now. From one instance of Elasticsearch, now it's three. Bosch took care of it.
All right, thank you very much.